The TARDIS doors fly open, and the doctor tells out of breath and battered. He slides across the floor, colliding with the console. The doors close. He lies there for a second.
Well, that could have gone better.
He reaches his hand up on the console in order to lift himself up. When it grabs the console, it begins to glow. He lifts his body up, allowing him to see his glowing hand. He stands up quickly and stares at it in complete surprise.
What? No. Now?
No.
He walks around the console, slowly and in pain, making small grunts of pain as he does so. He presses buttons and switches, making the TARDIS begin to fly. His other hand begins to glow. They both glow stronger. He steps back looking at them.
No. Stop!
His hands slam on the console. The glowing disappears.
I still have things to do.
The TARDIS lands in a bustling city. The doctor opens the door to the town square of New London. He looks around at the buildings until he sees a short one with the sign Muto Inc. He heads inside and goes up to the reception desk.
Hey, is someone called Rosemary Watkins here? I need to speak to her.
She puts her finger to her ear and begins to talk to someone, almost like she was on the phone.
Please say in the future we'll have to speak to one more receptionist. It slows everything down.
Thank you. He walks over to a chair in the centre of the lobby. He waits. As he does so, a stabbing pain begins to emerge within his tummy.
Ow. Hang on a second. New bowels. Quite an upgrade from before.
The doctor looks up suddenly and sees a tall woman standing over him. She looked very like someone he knew. She was holding a cup of coffee. He stands, extremely happy.
Ray!
He hugs her. She doesn't do the same back. The doctor separates himself from Ray to take a closer look at her.
Wow, you look different. I can definitely see the upgrade you made.
No, I'm just so happy to see you. Thank you for taking time off work for me.
Yes, now that is the question, isn't it?
He steps back, making it seem like he'll leave soon.
Please just do one thing for me. Just keep being astounding. You have a bumpy road ahead of you, and for that, I'm sorry. Really, really sorry.
The doctor begins to walk away. Ray calls to him. The doctor didn't answer. Instead, he walked out of the door. She walks off when suddenly an announcement comes in through the building speakers. She turns around and starts walking into the other direction, excited. Everyone else looks at her with glee. The people congratulate her. In response, she thanks them. She presses a button on the lift. The doors open, and she enters the lift. She then presses the lowest button inside of the lift. She waves goodbye to the crowd of happy people, and the doors of the lift shut. The doctor began to walk back to the TARDIS, every step being harder than the last. It seemed like the TARDIS was getting further and further away.
Ugh.
He reached his hand out and touched the cold metal handle, happy.
One more stop.
The TARDIS lands somewhere in the countryside, in front of a familiar house. It was dark outside, and all was quiet and still. The door of the TARDIS opened, and the Doctor staggered out. He looked around. He smiled when he saw the house. He left the TARDIS and closed the door. He began to walk towards the house. He opened the gate slowly as to not wake anyone up, and he had made it to the front garden. There he knelt in front of some upturned dirt and dug a little hole into it. Then he took out a small cream-coloured object. It looked like a small piece of coral. He placed this into the hole and covered it up. He then got up extremely difficultly and headed towards the blue door. Once there, he leaned against it, out of pain, and reached into his pocket once more and took out his sonic. He then shone the sonic at the door, and it clicked open. The Doctor opened the door and headed inside. As he stepped inside, his mind welled up with happiness. He looked to his left, looking into the living room, which, last time he saw it, was a complete mess. That was mainly his fault. He then looked away from the room as a tear started to pool in his eye.
No crying. Not yet.
He wiped his eyes, looked forward and saw the stairs opposite the front door, becoming visible from the moonlight. He began to climb them using the handle rail for support. Every step felt like a massive sap of energy lost, but he had more important things on his mind. As he reached the top of the stairs, he let out a quiet sigh of relief. He then looked down at his hands. They began to glow once more.
I said no!
He waved his hands in the air, much like you do to dry your hands when they are wet. This did the same effect, making this yellow energy leave his hands and dissipate into his surroundings. He sighed another sigh of relief and headed down the dark corridor as silently as he could. When he reached the end of the corridor, he found a door. It had a sign on it labelled, Sky's Room, All Welcome. On it were small drawings of space and microbes and such. The Doctor looked at it slowly, seeing more and more details that he wouldn't have seen at first glance. Then, there, in the corner, was a small drawing that made the Doctor smile. It was a small poncho, exactly like the one the Doctor was wearing.
I'm not having another person forget.
He entered the room and saw Skye slumped at her desk, lamp on. She was fast asleep. The Doctor entered the room and kneeled next to her.
Oh, Skye, I always knew you were a hard worker, but don't work yourself to exhaustion.
He stood up and turned off the lamp. He thought about carrying her to bed, but the Doctor knew he wasn't strong enough, even without the fact that he was injured. Instead, the Doctor just placed his index finger and middle finger on each hand of her temples. He then closed his eyes.
I want you to be the only person who remembers me.
Suddenly, images flash between the Doctor's mind and Skye's. Memories of their time together. Skye felt so happy remembering all these memories and having them in her head. Something she would never have been able to do without the Doctor. She woke up suddenly from her desk and looked around. It was morning. She looked behind her, expecting her faithful friend to be there, but instead, there was nothing. She felt saddened by this. Suddenly, she had a flash in her mind. She thought of the small coral-shaped object the doctor had planted. She jumped up and rushed down the stairs to confirm her thought. She opened the front door and ran outside to a patch of upturned dirt. She began to dig it up until she felt something in her hand. Something harder than the dirt. She picked it up and looked at it, confirming her thought. She smiled and put it back in the ground, covering it once more. As she stood up, she looked over towards the forest, thinking about the first day she had met this mysterious man. As she looked, she saw a square patch of grass which had been flattened in amongst all of the grass which had been untouched. She opened the gate and walked over to it. When she saw it, she had another flash, another memory. The doctor, her doctor, beginning to change. She smiled when she thought this and looked up into the sky, knowing exactly what had happened to the doctor, why she couldn't see him again, what that piece of coral was, and what was going to happen to her doctor. The doctor flicks one lever and the TARDIS takes off. He sighs and collapses on the sofa behind him. He looked at his hands, knowing what would be happening to them. Just as he thought, they were glowing an intense yellow.
No. No, not yet.
He stands up fiercely, banging his hands down on the cushions of the sofa to help him up. The fading disappeared.
I need to have a one-on-one with me. Give me that much at least.
He sighed again and began to walk around the console, exhausted.
You're not gonna remember any of this, Doctor. And although that's sad, that around about 2,000 to 3,000 years of your life have gone without you knowing, it could be a blessing in disguise.
He presses a few buttons on the console. The room begins to fade out of existence.
And because of that, I'm not going to help you remember. I'm reverting the console and my clothes back to how they were when I was the 13th Doctor. It'll be like me and 14 were never here. Ah, oh, what a dreadful look. Can't believe I liked this once. Whoops. There she goes again. You'll be getting a lot of that. Anyway, you can't remember me or 14. If I try and make you remember, and you succeed, who knows what would happen to the universe. The whole time I've been about, I've had people saying that I and 14 as doctors never existed. It's bound into time itself. If I had you remembering because of my selfishness, who knows where we would be at all. Think of it like meeting new people. If you only meet them once, you're extremely likely for them to forget you. Even close friends. Once that friendship dissolves, and the friends part ways, they may never remember each other again. Doctor, we're just people you've met on your travels.
Each regeneration, each new you, it's just a person that you'll know and then either remember or forget.
He sits down on one of the octagonal stairs and leans back, looking up at the ceiling.
And anyway, you don't want to remember what we did. Just think. The amount of mistakes 14 made was horrendous. It even got him killed. Although, I'm not one to talk. I'm probably a disgrace of a regeneration myself. Running around thinking I'm doing the right thing, but instead killing countless people. I probably have more deaths on my plate than any other regeneration. I even killed life on an entire planet. I haven't even been around for that long. Only about 100 years. And I spent 90 of those on some desolate planet moping. You don't want to remember that. He gets up and walks to the console. It may sound like I'm just wanting you to run away from the memories I don't like. For instance, the depression of 90 years, or the fact that I completely wiped out New Earth and put it in a time loop. Jeez, what a mess up. You're going to be confused about what happened there. But I don't want to run away. I want to be the only regeneration who has stopped running, who has turned around and who has dealt with their issues. And that's what I'm doing with this. Letting you, Doctor, carry on life with a semi-clean slate whilst I suffer for what I have done. I think being wiped from existence is the right punishment for 4,500 years of pain. And the best part? You won't remember the punishment. How great is that? He stands there in silence, just listening to the TARDIS engines. He sighs. If I'm honest, I'm really scared. None of us know where we'll be after we regenerate. Is it like dying? Is it just like turning into a new person? Even so, all those memories will be gone. And I won't even be the same person I am now. Memories define a personality. And well, my personality will be gone along with the memories. But is that so bad? You don't want to be like me, right? His hands glow once more. He looked at them intently. The time's closing near, Doctor. I can feel your very being inside of me. And well, I can feel myself disappearing. I always forget how this feels. I regenerated what? 16 times now? And I still always forget. That's very much like me. Not that you'll know. He looked around at his feet, trying to work out where to stand. Now then, where do I stand? Where did 13 stand? Here, was it? I better be right. I don't want this to go wrong. He shuffles around for a second before looking up at the console. Oh girl. Thank you for being mostly reliable. You always did what I asked of you. So do one more thing for me, will you? don't say a thing to the new doctor, or any of the new doctors. They can't know about me or 14. Understand? Good. I always knew I could rely on you.
He stands there in silence, his hands glowing stronger.
I'm sorry, Doctor. I'm dragging this out, aren't I? To be honest, you're taking your time getting here, so it's not all me.
His hands glow stronger still.
There you are. Doctor, it was a pleasure being you. It was a pleasure being the True 15.